That's Ronnie Chang. Don't you ever ask him to tap the microphone, Brian.
Sorry, Mr. Chang.
It's okay.
I apologize.
It's okay. You're here for my lawyer. Thanks for having me on, man. Good to see you. I'm glad you're okay.
Yeah, good to see you. Are you overseas right now?
Yeah, I'm in Australia. So thanks for making it suitable to my time. Yeah.
Of course. Are you filming a movie?
I was. Yeah, I rapped. Yeah, I rapped
you
on the movie.
And that's why you're out there?
Yeah, yeah. Well, I mean, it was supposed to be a 2-week filming, and then it became 5 months of refugee, you know, like, yeah. No, in a good way. I mean, because, you know, my wife is Australian, and I don't know if you want to save this for a podcast, but...
No, we're live now. We're recording, bro.
Oh. Okay,
we don't start this show. We just start talking.
Yeah, we just start talking, man. And I love it.
Is video also live?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
It's not live. Oh. He just means we're recording. We're in the show.
Yeah, we're recording.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. So this show has video?
Yes.
Oh.
If you don't want it, we don't need it.
No. I wish I put something on, but anyway.
Why would you want something on? You're so known for one, your expensive suits, your amazing
They're not that expensive.
Your amazing fucking hairline. I mean, you
none of
have
which
that.
I have right now.
Yeah, yeah. That's why this is the raw Ronnie. This is the Ronnie without gel. This is the Ronnie without mega hold, which is what you normally use.
Are you filming this from like a UNICEF like children's fund? Why is there a crying baby behind you?
That's my son, and we're also raising money for my son to have a happier life. Thank you for pointing that out.
Yeah, it's this giant crying baby behind you. Normally when people design their own custom podcast studios, they have a picture of a car or like
really shitty drapes behind them with a door with a post-it.
Hey, board, I'm in my in-laws' house. Also, you didn't tell me this was a video podcast.
Ronnie, don't talk shit about my background when you're in the living room of your fucking aunt's house. Stop.
I'm in my in-laws' house, and they're very respectful to their parents. They have old photos of their parents on the walls. I am perfectly happy about this.
Yeah.
I'm very happy they let me stay in their house, so I got no complaints with this house, man.
You're at your in-laws' house, and one of the in-laws is a gamer, and that's why they have a gamer's chair that you're sitting in.
No, you're
full of shit, bro.
Dude,
you're full
this
of shit,
chair?
Ronnie.
Dude, okay, first of all, my brother-in-law is a gamer. Second of all, this chair looks, when I first saw it, I was like, what kind of nerd has this kind of chair? Yo, you sit in this chair one time, your life changes. This chair ends chairs.
This is the end of it.
Yeah.
What's so great about it?
It just fits like every hole in your body. Like, you don't even know how bad your chair is right now. I guarantee you, you don't even know how shitty the chair you're sitting. Look at this. You're like in a rocking chair. I don't even know.
I'm in a rocking chair. It's awful.
Once you sit in this, it's like, you're ready to work now. You're ready to work and sleep at the same time. It's hard to explain.
Well, gamers' chairs are built for people that sit on their ass for 8 hours. And that's the truth. Because when they game forever. So they got the lower lumbar. They got the headrest. It's designed like a Porsche Panamera seat. I sit on a wooden rocking chair because when my ass goes numb, that's usually 45 minutes into the fucking pod. I know I got 15 minutes to wrap it up.
Yeah, man. Look at this. You got your own Funko toy, but you can't get like a cool background and a comfortable chair, man. Jesus.
All right. You better slow down, mister. You got a hat rack behind you and you don't even wear any of those hats, Ronnie.
This isn't my house, man. I don't know.
Whatever.
Yeah, this isn't my dream LA house I built off of selling out Hawaii 50 times in a row.
Hey.
I was just saying how you got to leave some money for the Hawaiians. Joe, you're taking too much money from them, man. They got no money left.
Community.
You keep doing shows there and selling arenas and then building podcast studios with crying babies and rocking. It doesn't make any sense.
Whatever, bro. You better slow down. I want to say this. I was so proud to see you smash it in Crazy Rich Asians. I know this is something that, you know, it's, you know, we always like when someone talks to Ronnie, we got to bring up the movie. A, it was a legendary movie. It was the first of its kind, that big of a cast, that much talent. And for you to have the chops that you did right off the bat, bro, that opening scene when you took the picture with your family.
Oh, thanks so much, man. Thanks so much, yeah. It was a
killer scene, man. And you established that character from the beginning and you maintained it the whole way. I love that character. You were so funny in it. And it wasn't that far of a stretch from Ronnie, but it was good. It was dope, dude. I love
barely
it.
Acting.
It was a great
barely
character.
Acting. I didn't even read the script. Yeah. I just went on.
Was it a stretch? Like, I love that character. It was so good. It was
thanks a lot.
And
yeah,
I appreciate
yeah.
it. Yeah, man.
No, I'm very good at playing that type of role that doesn't that douchebag who doesn't care. It just comes very natural to me. I don't know what to say, but no, I mean, I was just a small part in that thing, you know. I'm very glad that I was able to be a part of it, and it sounds like I'm going into auto mode right now, but it's truly how I believe that, like, there's a lot of really talented people working on that, much more talented than me, you know. They made us all look good, and also I'm really happy that I feel like the community really got behind it, you know. I feel like the
100
Asian American community among really got behind it. That was important for all of us to make something
all
that people could get behind. And you know how it is, man. It's hard to make things. It's hard to make things. Period. It's hard to 100. Make things authentic. It's hard to make things that people get behind, even if everything lines up. You know, and that was like my first ever film, and so my whole thing is like, yeah, $200 million, or I'm not doing that movie. You know, but it's such a weird experience for that to be your first film, and then see, like, damn, the number of things that had to go right for something to be quote unquote successful. Like, let me break it. I don't need to break it down for you, but just for people listening in, it's like, imagine you need a good story, then you need a good script, then you need a good director, then you need good actors, then you need it to be edited well, and even if the movie is killer, then you need the marketing to nail it, you know. All these things have to align. Like, for anything, for that many things to align, the odds of that happening are very, very rare, you know. So you know, you can have a good film or good project that isn't marketed well. I'm sure you've experienced that, you know.
Well, 100%.
Yeah,
what I love. Oh, I'm sorry to interrupt you, Ronnie. Yeah. But what I loved about that movie is when it was shot and cut and edited, everything that was put together to screen it. All right, I wasn't part of the screening process, but I'm just saying, for you to screen that movie in front of potential people that are going to market or get behind it, put financial, you know, money behind it. First 10 minutes, it's already a wrap. That opening scene was fucking, it was a wrap.
Right.
It was done.
No, I'm glad.
Like, you couldn't get behind, if you didn't get behind that movie, then something was wrong with you. You know what I mean? Because the first 10 minutes, you were in it. You were like, oh shit, I gotta stay in this movie.
Right.
Am I right?
I'm glad. And yeah, and I mean, I feel that way. And genuinely, Warner Brothers marketing, they really did care. You know, it's easy to be cynical about these people, about they're just grabbing the money, but they really did care. Like what you said, they held focus groups with communities, Asian American communities, to try to get the marketing right and get their feedback on stuff, you know. Because, and let's be, if you want to play the dollars game and be super cynical, let's be honest here, they don't need to play, they can just play the white people and win the money game,
because
the population size, they didn't need to do that, but they wanted to make something authentic. Hey, even John Chu said as much. He said, like, they could have taken a big payday and gone to Netflix for life-changing money. It's how it was described to me. But John felt, John and to be fair, his producers, Nina Jacobson, Brad Simpson, everyone there, they felt very strongly that it needed a theatrical release. They wanted to give it that theatrical release, you know? And so a lot of people made this film with agendas other than pure money, which in showbiz, American show business, that's, you know, that's such a rare thing to happen, you know? And we can be cynical that it made tons of money and whatever, you know, they're playing off a untapped market. But when we were making it, there were no guarantees, man. I mean, when we were making it, we couldn't even get the airline to appear in it, you know, like, so it wasn't like this was a surefire hit from the start. You know, a lot of people took a lot of risks and made some good decisions and backed authentic storytelling in it, you know? So I'm glad people kind of, it resonated with people and if people got behind it. You know, I'm always, especially fellow creators like yourself, you know, to watch stuff and to watch other people's stuff and go like, yeah, there's something cool here, you know?
Yeah, it was more than just a movie for someone like me. I'm half white, half Asian. So I already struggle with an identity crisis, you know, when I was growing up. It was always searching. You know what I mean? Like, I have a Filipino mom, I have a white dad. You know what I mean? And when people ask what I was, I'd always tell them about my Filipino culture. And if you could just put yourself back in my time when I was a kid, I didn't have a movie like Crazy Rich Asians. I didn't have stuff like that where I could be like a conversation when I'm at work or something I could grab a hold of and embrace. So, you know, just like for an example, when I found out that Lou Diamond Phillips was Filipino in La Bamba, that was a very proud moment for me. That was a very big moment for me. Yeah. Unfortunately, he was playing a Latino character, which is still amazing, but it was still like, something like a Crazy Rich Asians when I was a kid.
I think people
When it finally happened, of course I had it. Like, it was more than just a movie for me. It was something for me to like get behind and let everybody know, like, yo, this is our moment and we need to embrace this. Like, finally. Like, and not only that, it was fucking good. So, like, everyone should watch this. Yeah,
thankfully,
man.
It was good. Yeah, it has to be good, you know. You can't represent if it's not good. That's the bottom line. You know, it's harder to get behind things unless they're good. And so we're lucky that this was good. And I feel the same way. Like, when I found out Keanu Reeves was like a quarter Chinese or something, what? It was like, what?
Bro, it was like crazy. It's so funny because you try and explain, like, I try and explain that to like my kid or anyone that's of this generation. You know, everything is everything's in the palm of their hand. They can find out about somebody in minutes. But for me to find out that Rob Schneider was half Filipino in a movie, when I'm watching, I think it was Hot Chick or whatever, or Deuce Bigelow in the theater, and he says babinka, which is a Filipino dessert, I'm like, I'm looking at everybody in the theater like, yo, that dude's Filipino. Like, it was a big moment for me.
Yeah,
you know
absolutely.
What I mean? And it's funny, like, we laugh at it now, but like you got to put like me in that time and like just struggling with my own identity and just finding something that can inspire me. You know what I mean?
Yeah, still in this time.
My inspiration. But but it is. You are right. But what you guys did was you opened a very big door. You guys kicked down double doors. And now Hollywood sees the potential and sees that it doesn't have to be a demographic that you're selling to. Everybody loved that story. It was a love story. Yeah. And it has nothing to do with who's playing it or whatever.
I love how Joe's, we never got a chance to debrief about it. So this is our first time talking about the movie. But,
the other guy, man, I want you to know, Ronnie, hold on. I'm sorry to interrupt you because I want to get it off my chest. No, like, please. I really want you, and I'm pretty sure you guys already do, but to embrace what you did, like, really understand that you really did make a movement happen and you were a part of it. You're at the forefront of that and you were part of that cast. It was from director to writer to fucking cast. You guys knocked the doors down in Hollywood, and you did that. That's amazing,
well,
man.
Well,
you get to attach your name to that.
Yeah, I'm very, very proud to be attached of that project and any good project. And I mean, you know, it was a lot of people, so we were lucky to be the conduits of it. We were lucky to be, you know, everyone wanted to be in that movie, so. We were lucky to be the ones chosen to be in it, but honestly, it was a lot of people's work, man. A lot of people behind the scenes, and again, a lot of community people. Man, the community support that, like, even till today, people will never know how much community support went into it, like, selflessly. Like, the people were, like, just trying to – it was almost like campaigning for president. I remember people were, like, trying to get – yo, you got to go watch this movie. You got to go watch the movie. And no one was paying anyone to do it.
I was one of those guys.
I know. You were one of those guys.
Bro, I only knew two people in that fucking movie, man. You know what I mean? And I was, like, it wasn't even about that. It was just about, like – it was kind of like a prove-it moment. Like I remember I bought my ticket right away. I bought it online, which I rarely do. And then I went to go see it. And not only that, I really genuinely loved the movie. And I was behind it because I wanted to be like, this is that door we need to kick down. You know what I mean? And you guys did it. And it was just beautiful. So I understand what you're saying, that like we all came together for that. You know what I mean?
Yeah, we came together. It was nice to have a rally point that made sense and was good, you know, because like, again, like I said before, it's hard to represent unless something's actually good. And so I really like what you said before, because I kind of say that all the time. It's, you know, it's easy to be cynical and hate and like see the flaws in things. And I'm kind of motivated by being very self-critical. So I can understand that kind of urge to be critical. But if you watch this movie and you don't see anything redeeming about it, I mean, that's just not right. You know, to say that it's objectively not correct to go like nothing about this movie was good, because even if you didn't like the movie, like the real legacy of the movie is that it provided a baseline of storytelling for Asian American stories 100%. In America. Yeah, so even if you don't like what the hell it was, you at the very least you should appreciate
the story.
And the baseline it created, so that you can, because we had people in this that in America that were like we had multi-dimensional Asian characters in this, which sounds like a no-brainer now, but that doesn't really happen. You know, like we had characters who are in love. We had characters who are insecure. We had characters who are confident. We had characters who are douchebags, who are good guys. We had all these different, you know, and so to see, to see that happen in America is very interesting, you know. And you compare that to I don't know if you remember Jet Li in Romeo Must Die, or was it Cradle to the Grave? It was with Aaliyah. Which one was with Aaliyah? Yeah.
It was Cradle to the Grave. Romeo Must Die.
I'm pretty sure
that was it, right, Brian?
I'll check.
Yeah, it was Jet Li and Aaliyah. And they were the two leads. Jet Li at his prime, like badassery. And there was a scene in that movie where at the end of the movie they kiss.
Romeo Must Die.
Yeah, Romeo Must Die. They kiss.
I went to the theater for that.
And they screened it to test audiences. And in America, test audiences were like, like they couldn't see this Asian guy kiss this African American woman, and so they cut it from the movie. You know,
so
and,
crazy.
Wow.
Yeah, they cut that scene from the movie because it, and so my point is like that's what the fight is, you know? That's what the fight is against, is stuff like that where people can't even see Asian actors in different characters or in roles like that, you know? So I mean, even if you don't like the story of the movie, but I can't see how you can watch this thing and get nothing out of it. That's something with you. You know what I mean? There's something inside you that you need to deal with. Because it's a happy rom-com, and it kind of set the baseline level for storytelling, so you can build on that and you can make a farewell. You can make I know Parasite's from South Korea, but accepting a South Korean movie in America. You know, I went to watch Parasite in cinemas in America, and I remember watching in the theater and Parasite comes on subtitles, right? English subtitles. And I remember watching it, and the vibe in the room was like you're watching any other movie. It didn't feel like we were watching a foreign film. It felt like we were watching like a Oscar nominated film, you know? And that's awesome. The kind of vibe you want. Yeah, that's the kind of vibe you want to create. You want to normalize Asian people in American storytelling, you know?
Joe, you know, the t-shirt is a menswear staple. Obviously, you're a big t-shirt guy. I love my t-shirts. But it's long be plagued by horrible condition.
Okay, one thing I hate, Brian, are bad t-shirts, okay? It's the material, and it's also the cut. And I know I'm using cut as a pun, but unfortunately, I'm being for real on this one. Yeah, I hate badly cut shirts. Sometimes they're too short, sometimes they're too long. And why don't you tell them about cuts, t-shirts?
Well, they got a new word for it. They call it something bacon neck. And I'm like, I know exactly what you mean. It's when it goes, like, it all gets all rippled around it. Bacon neck, shrinkage, color fade, parachute fit. That's a new one for me. Wrinkles and stretching, to name a few. No matter how long you've settled for basic tees, it's long enough. Besides, every classic deserves a modern take, which is why we're talking to you guys today about Cuts Clothing. They've completely changed the game. Their t-shirt has enough quality and style to wear in the office, on a date, or anywhere in between. So now you don't have to choose between a classic look and a modern feel.
But most importantly, they feel good. Like, I love wearing them. They're soft on the skin. They're not rough. Like, they don't use that cheap cotton. They use that good premium cotton, you guys. Cuts. I love it.
Yep. You can choose your collar, crew, V-neck, Henley. You can choose your cut, elongated split hem, or the classic curve hem. They got a great mix of long sleeve, short sleeve, collars, cuts, and colors. We'll have you ready for any situation. And that's why Cuts is the only shirt worth wearing.
The only shirt worth wearing. Mm-hmm. Let's emphasize that. I'm telling you, once you wear a Cuts t-shirt, you're not going to want to wear anything else, you guys.
It's loved by your favorite athletes, entrepreneurs, and even podcast hosts like Mr. Joe Coy. It seems like everyone is wearing Cuts these days. And our listeners can get 15% off your first order by going to cutsclothing.com/...
Koypond, K-O-Y-P-O-N-D. That's yeah. Koypond, K-O-Y-P-O-N-D.
Cutsclothing.com/Koypond for 15% off the only shirt worth wearing.
Let's go.
Joe, in this new reality, I'm going to talk about online therapy with BetterHelp.
Yeah. We all need that. You know, we're in a time where a lot of people are in their heads right now. It's a hard, hard time for a lot of people. And the best way to get help is to talk to someone. And not a lot of us have someone to talk to. So yeah. I do love this new sponsor. Why don't you tell them about it?
Well, it's great. It's their BetterHelp. They will assess your needs and match you with your own licensed professional therapist. You can start communicating in under 48 hours. It's not a crisis line. It's not self-help. It's professional counseling done securely online, yes. Which is great because, you know, everything's really got to be online these days, and they're already set up for it. There's a broad range of expertise available, which may or may not be locally available to you in many areas. The service is available for clients worldwide.
Yes, and you know what's also crazy is I get therapy. You know what I mean? Everyone,
me too.
And I strongly preach it all the time. You know, sometimes you can't talk to your best friend, you can't talk to your girlfriend, you can't talk to a family member. You need to talk to someone that's not gonna show bias,
right?
You know what I mean?
Independent observer.
You need someone to just be on the outside, hear your story, and then give a nice, beautiful, objective suggestion. And one thing that annoys me is when you're having these type of issues or these type of thoughts, that long drive there or waiting in the lobby.
Yes.
Like that's why I love the best about BetterHelp. And that's why, like, sometimes, like, when I'm going through that, sometimes I turn around and I'm like, I ain't got time for this. The cool thing about this is you can log right on and get right to it.
You can message your therapist anytime. You can be like, I need to get this off my chest and just pull it out. Just log in, and in the middle of the night, you got to say your thing. You say it, and you can set it up for your next session. It's great. You'll get timely and thoughtful responses. Plus, you can schedule weekly video or phone sessions, so you won't ever have to wait in that waiting room. BetterHelp is committed to facilitating great therapeutic matches, so they make it easy and free to change counselors if needed, which is obviously super important. You need that really good match, you know, with a really good counselor. And it's more affordable than traditional offline counseling, and financial aid is available. BetterHelp wants you to start living a happier life today. And you can visit BetterHelp.com/Koypond. That's BetterHelp, HELP/Koypond. And join the over 1 million people taking charge of their mental health with the help of an experienced professional.
Do it, you guys. You know, nothing better than a healthy mind. It's the most important thing.
Yep.
Be healthy. You know, help yourself, and BetterHelp is there to help you.
Yep. And in fact, it's working so well that they are actually recruiting additional counselors in all 50 states. And there's a special offer for the Koypond listeners. They get 10% off your first month at betterhelp.com/Koypond.
Nice. Yeah. It was amazing. That was an amazing time. And it was so cool because, you know, not only did I watch that in the theater, but it was also cool to go see Searching, which was also Asian. Mm-hmm. And indirectly was Asian without promoting that it was Asian. It was Henry Cho, his brother John Cho, was Asian John Cho. In the movie. Oh, I'm sorry, John Cho. Henry Cho is a comedian. I'm sorry. Who I need to get on this podcast. Henry Cho, I love you. One of the first ones to do it. Thick fucking country accent, but one of my favorite comics. John Cho, in the movie, his brother's Asian, the daughter's Asian. And, you know, at the same time, while Crazy Rich Asians just played, these two movies were crushing numbers in the box office. You know what I mean? It was just, it was a good time for cinema. And I can't wait for that to continue happening. And then on top of that, you're the senior correspondent over at the Daily Show, which is another thing that's really amazing that you're doing. You know what I mean? Like, that's another position that we didn't, you know, people of this generation get to see. and respect. You know what I mean? Like, that's a very respected show. And here you are running the, you know, you're a senior correspondent. That's dope, bro. So congratulations to that.
Yeah,
and
thanks so much.
Yeah.
I think a lot of this is just like, I believe in storytelling, and I consider comedy to be storytelling as well. Like, it's my shit. Yeah. It's about authenticity, right? So people get behind things which are authentic, you know, the authenticity resonates. And I think part of what we're seeing is just that to authentically describe society in 2020, you have to see these other faces. If you don't see, it's weird. It's like, how are they
very weird.
Yeah, it's how they know Asian people, how they know Black people, how they know Latino people, because that's how society is right now. And so if you don't show that, and, you know, not diversity for the sake of it, which is tokenism, you show it because that's authentically how you can tell these stories, you know. And that
100%.
I think that's
there's no difference. There's no difference from me talking like my mom to get my point across without telling you I'm Filipino, but understanding that my mom is my mom. And my mom is just like your mom. Mine just happens to be Filipino, but they're doing mom shit. And there's no difference from me doing, no difference from me doing my mom. And there's no difference from Eddie Murphy doing his mom.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Eddie talks about his mom throwing the slipper across the room. And she's like, you better get your ass to bed. Bah. There's no difference from that. And my mom going, Joseph, go to sleep. Like, there's no difference. Absolutely. If I have to get into character for you to get it, then people relate. Yeah, and that's why I love storytelling. And that's why, like, when you guys did the movie Crazy Rich Asians, it was like, it felt like this, and I'm bringing it back to me, and I hate doing this shit, but if you could just imagine me starting in 1989 and trying to indirectly tell people that I'm half Asian, and people, you know, like you said earlier, it was like acting as if you don't get it just because I'm saying something that's Filipino, but you do get it because that's a mom story. Does that make sense?
Yeah. I mean, that's what really attracts me to stand-up comedy as well is you talk about all this stuff, and, you know, I sound the way I sound and I look the way I look, and my mom is Singaporean, you know, Malaysian Chinese. But when I talk about her, it's not about the race. It's just about her doing mom stuff, as you said, and people get behind it. And then what happens is that when people get behind a joke, you also kind of get them behind the idea that, you know, we all have the same kind of thoughts, you know, mm-hmm. even though you look at people and you might have a language barrier. And so you think that they might be less sophisticated in how they see the world. It's like, that's not true, man. It's like, we all have the same thoughts. We all get annoyed at the same things, you know, bro. It's not even about race. And then I feel like that kind of, you know, it kind of makes everyone understand each other a little bit better. I think
100%. That we can all
get angry at the same thing. So
I
totally get behind it. Yeah, and let's talk about you for a second here, because people don't know that this guy, Joel Coy, has been coming out to Australia for a little bit now. And I know white Australian comedians, the whitest Australian comics, who till today, when I was coming up in Australia, I would ask them who was the best one they ever saw, and they said Joel Coy at the Comics Lounge in Melbourne, Australia.
I love the Comics Lounge. Yeah. I love that room.
You know the Comics Lounge in Melbourne?
Yeah, man. I know those guys. I know Dan and those guys. Yeah.
Hey, Brian.
Sorry.
Shut the fuck up. It's a compliment it's a compliment on me. Let me enjoy this compliment.
Let's back it up one more time, Ronnie.
Let's go ahead.
Still Saunders, Melbourne, Australian comic. He now lives in LA, but longtime Melbourne comic. You know, he still was kind of headlining when I was starting out. And he told me, man, the best, it wasn't even, you know, I shouldn't need to qualify this, but it wasn't even who is the best American comic, who is the best Asian comic. I was like, who's the best one you saw at the Comics Lounge? He was like, Joel Coy came in and just destroyed the goddamn place, like in 2000 and must have been 10 or 11, something like that. It wasn't super long ago, but it was recent, you know. So,
thank you.
Killing it everywhere, like that kind of legendary killing it where people talk about it afterwards for years.
Thank you.
For like a Australia was the first one to embrace outside of America.
Big time. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, everywhere embraces you, right? Is there a place that you've been to that doesn't?
It was crazy. I played Malaysia and it sold out like 6 months in advance. It was like 4,000 people. It was crazy. Absolutely nuts. And then Australia, I played the Super Theater. Have you played that? It's enormous. It was like 9,000 people. And I was just like, I pinch myself. I pinch
which
myself
city?
Every day.
Which city?
That was Sydney.
Oh, Sydney? Yeah.
Yeah.
No, Australia's my... Esther is my territory. I started here. I do okay here. I'm not doing Joe Coy numbers over here. Okay. So this guy coming in, killing it. And yo, my agents, even my agents in America will tell me, you know, when I do that California circuit, the what's those improvs? The big ones. They said, yeah, yo, what's the one in like near Orange County?
Oh, that's improv as well. That's the improv.
Yeah, all those improvs there. They were telling me Joe Coy was the one who, that's how he built up his whole thing. He would keep selling out these improvs in like, what's that? Is that Southern California? I'm so ignorant.
Yeah.
I'm
not LA Orange guy. County, Orange County, yeah. Brea. Yeah, Ontario.
Brea, all these places were like Joe Coy territory where he would come back over and over again and sell that. And that's how he built it up. And so,
yeah,
you know, that's what my agents would tell me to go and do these places. And you know, I'd be like, man, these venues are way too big for me. And they'd be like, well, that's how Joe, that's how he started from there and built it up. So if you want to get to selling more tickets, you have to kind of, you know, that's a path to go as well. And then the other thing was when I was doing my special, and people don't know this, but my Netflix special, because I was researching the venue and I saw that Joe actually did film the special in the same venue I was going to film in like years before.
Alex Theater,
yeah. And so I just messaged Joe one day. I said, like, hey, do you have any like specific tips with the venue? Because I'm about to perform there. And then he, you know, Joe Coy called me up and then he was like, yo, mic up the balcony, because the acoustics in there suck. Like, but mic it up so that you can get the feedback. And damn, if you didn't tell me that, you know, I would have screwed it up. The sound is so important, especially the audio feedback.
So important. Especially in that room. And that's why when you asked me, I was like, I gotta tell this guy about the audio.
Yeah.
That was my biggest mistake that I made when I shot at the Alex Theater. And I'm glad you did it, because by the way, that special killed, man. You rocked.
Oh,
that
thanks
special,
so much,
man.
Yeah, and so yeah, I gave you a shout out in the credits for that. But like but stuff like that. It's like very specific performer questions, you know, that you managed to you told me about. Like, otherwise, we wouldn't know. You know, we were filming it. Essentially, it was a pretty rushed job. You know, it was a very rushed thing we had to do. So thanks for the feedback, man. Thanks 100%. For the heads up on that.
Fuck yeah, man. Right. Yeah. Well, Brian, what do you have for Ronnie, man? Because you know, Brian is an improv guy, but he's also a JFL guy. That's why my relationship with Brian goes way back.
Well, Ronnie,
and one thing Brian knows is every fucking comic, even the comics that don't know that Brian, they may not know Brian. Brian knows all about that comic, and
right.
We had Ronnie at the New York Comedy Festival a few years back.
That's right.
And I remember that you crushed. And I remember taking a good shot of you taking the stage from backstage that I texted you after.
Yeah.
You remember that was a pretty good picture. But what I really want to talk about is the special at the Comics Lounge in Melbourne, Australia. They have this meal, right? It is chicken parmesan, okay? Over fries. Okay. So they have a whole plate of French fries.
Okay.
And then they have a chicken parmesan cutlet, and then they cover the whole thing in sauce and cheese. And then that is a meal that they serve there.
Yeah.
Yeah. Chicken parma.
It's fucking unbelievable.
Chicken parma?
They don't just serve. That's an Australian thing, man.
Oh yeah,
chicken
is
parma.
It everywhere?
Yeah, they do that. And you know that chicken parma got me through many a night, because when I was starting out, I would go at the comic shops. I'd go into the kitchen and essentially like be like, hey, is there any leftovers here? And that guy, that chef guy, will always hook me up with that. So shout out that chicken parma. That chicken parma is killer. Yeah.
Shout out to the brothers of the Comics Lounge. Yeah. It's Dan and
Grant Lee.
Grant. That's right, Grant.
They are they are really good guys. Really unintentionally funny people as well.
They're awesome.
They're great. But Comics Lounge is such a weird thing to be connected to. Yeah,
it's a good room. Really so good fun. Room.
Yeah, yeah.
Ronnie, you're Malaysian, Chinese, and what else?
Malaysian, Chinese. That's it. I'm just.
Oh, that's
I'm,
it.
Yeah, I'm Chinese. I'm ethnically Chinese, and my nationality.
But you're from Malaysia.
Yeah, Malaysia. Yeah,
Malaysian. Okay, yeah, cool. Yeah.
And I mean, I lived in Singapore for a long time. My mom lives in Singapore now, and uh-huh. I went to Australia for university, and I started doing comedy in Australia. So that's wow. why there's like all these different countries in it. Yeah.
Did you start? Oh, go ahead, Brian.
Well, I was just gonna say, did you struggle finding a way to get up a ton when you were developing in Australia? Because I find that's a lot of Australians' challenges. Yeah. There's not that many dedicated comedy venues. Like even the Comics Lounge is only open like four nights a week in the heavy season.
Yeah,
right?
But so, you don't. Yeah, no, so that's like a great mics, point.
You know what I mean? Like you know, you can't just go club to club to club and get up 20 times a week like people do when they go to New York and they're trying to get real sharp. You know? So
yeah,
how did
no,
you get
this
so
is,
sharp?
This is becoming real inside baseball comedy, Australian comedy, but okay, yeah.
People inside stuff on this show. I think people like hearing about the process of comedy.
No, I could talk about comedy forever, so I know I'm in the right job. So yeah, you're right. The stage time isn't like America, but you don't know what you don't have. So we didn't know we were, you know, we suspect that we weren't getting enough stage time, but we didn't. I mean, that's the norm in Australia was right. to... You could do you in Australia. There's enough comedy rooms and clubs in Melbourne, which is a capital city, right? So not every city in Australia has this, but Melbourne, which is considered the comedy capital, you could do a spot every night, one spot every night of the week, but you couldn't do that every week. So if you did, let's say, you know, three spots a night 1 week, the next week you might do one, and then a week after that you might do none, and then so that you're right, there is a huge limit. And the way we would do it is because of the Melbourne International Comedy Festival, we would, the entire Melbourne and Australian comedy scene would essentially like structure their lives and careers creatively around that once a year festival.
For our listeners to know, like Melbourne, the Melbourne Comedy Festival has grown to be a massive international comedy festival. It is a big deal for comedians now.
Yeah, and the way we do it there isn't like Montreal where you come with 5-10 minutes, you know. In Melbourne International Comedy Festival, is more like the Edinburgh Fringe, which is, so you got to come with like an hour. Wow. So it becomes, people become, you know, the style here becomes a little bit more storytelling.
Right.
A little bit more indulgent sometimes, but
that UK style,
and you get great, you know, when it works, it's great. And then when it doesn't work, it's like, well, some of you guys probably shouldn't be doing an hour, but some of these hours are amazing, you know? So you get, you know, it's just like anything, you know,
kind of more about personality than about hard punchlines sometimes.
Sometimes more about definitely more about the story. Yeah. Mm-hmm, and people give you a time of day here, you know, because they pay money to see a 1 hour show. They give you a bit more rope, which can make you a little sloppy when it comes to 10 minute sets. But it also allows you to think of storytelling as a whole, you know, think of an hour as a whole instead of like these discrete 5 minute things. And my whole thing in Australia was that I always preferred that American style of being sharper in the 10 minutes. So by Australian standards, I was kind of more of a, like a 10 minute guy more than an hour guy. But by American standards, I'm more of a 1 hour guy.
Right. Interesting. Yeah. The thing I love about this whole thing is that we're inventing it. Like there's the UK and the Australia like scene of comedy, and then there's the American, but like there's nowhere else in the universe where it's happening. So it's like, this is the creation of these formats.
Sure. Well, I will say that and Joe knows this, like in Southeast Asia, it's kind of building. And
right.
So there are other places doing it, but you can see them doing it. And that, you know, I think I can only speak for Malaysia and Singapore. The scene there is very healthy now and it's growing and great comics are there coming out, and they're doing, you know, Malaysian comedy for Malaysians. You know, previously everyone was kind of doing like a, you know, like American comic tribute band, you know, they try to talk about Chicago in Malaysia. Like nobody's talking about Chicago. Yeah. But now they're, you know, they're talking about Malaysian stuff, which is cool. And with the scene, you can see people make the mistakes that, you know, people
that were made here 15 years ago or whatever.
Trusting the wrong people, the shady characters. So it's funny, but they learn very quick because they learn. They are able to. They're able to gain knowledge from the places that have it for a bit longer, which is America and the UK. You're not wrong. Like America and UK kind of pioneered the art form for sure, but it is kind of coming up in its own way in different places. Yeah.
Yeah. You know what I love is due to YouTube and all these streaming services like Netflix or whatever, you know what I mean? You realize that English is also a second language everywhere. And not only is it a second language, but they're also getting the humor, the inside joke, you know what I mean? Instead of over-explaining. And I got that when I went to Malaysia, you know what I mean? I didn't change my bit. I didn't. And that's very intimidating when someone gets booked in Malaysia. You're like, dude, are they going to get it? And if you just walk up and be yourself, they get it. So my question to you, Ronnie, is you said you grew up in Malaysia, Singapore? I'm sorry. Where'd you grow up?
Yeah, both. I don't differentiate between the two. I was the guy who I woke up in Malaysia, Johor Bahru. I would take the school bus to Singapore in the morning. So I'd be between two different countries. Yeah.
So English is your second language. It's spoken there, or like when you're being taught, is it taught in the schools? Like why is it so you speak it naturally? Like it is your language.
Yeah. English is the lingua franca. In my case, English is my first language, but English is the lingua franca in Malaysia and Singapore. I mean, probably because we used to be British colonies. So that stuff trickles down, you know, but Singapore's education system is English is the first language.
That's beautiful, man. And that's why when I shot my special in the Philippines for In His Elements, a lot of people think, oh, Filipinos only speak the language. It's like, no, we've been speaking English for 100 years now. They speak English, they get it, they sing. Look at Al Pineda, Arnel Pineda with The Journey. Like we speak and sing English, and it's like, that's what I love about these streaming services. Like people don't know that Ronnie spoke English, and that's something that a lot of people in Malaysia and Singapore speak.
It's funny. Dude, I got to tell you, when the American comics come to Singapore and Malaysia, or even the Australian comics come, it's so funny, the conversations, they ask me stuff because everyone gets nervous, like you said. Yeah. And then they ask like hey, do they have traffic lights here? Do they have Catholic? Someone asked me, hey, do they have Catholics here? Do they know what Catholics are? And I'm like, dude, they fucking know everything. Just do everything. They'll get it. Because sometimes the Americans come down, the Australians come down, and they just, it's that really innocent ignorance of like, guys have this here? You guys have it? Okay, yeah. So in America, we have Catholics, right? And these guys, some of them are bad. And it's like, dude, we don't, just do the bit. Like, it's even worse when you explain it.
Yeah,
and,
exactly.
Yeah, just do the bit. Like, we get it now. It's 2020. Okay, we've been looking. We watch Spotlight. We get what Catholics are.
It's like when people go to do new faces in Montreal, a bunch of them every year think that they have to be like, bonjour, speak English, you know what I mean? To the crowd.
And
the crowd is like, fuck you. We speak English.
It's pretty crazy how much that's true though, because you can even go to, Joe, you know this. This is right up your alley. There's like an Eastern European circuit, Serbia. Yeah. Holland, Russia, same thing.
Yep.
And those guys, same thing. They come to see you and you speak English and it's fine. Everyone gets it.
It's crazy, man.
Yeah.
I'm not going to lie. It really did blow my mind. Like, you know what I mean? Especially because it was a different type of, I'm doing theaters and shit, and I'm nervous and they're sold out. I'm like, really? I'm going to Holland right now? What the fuck? I'm going to. So anyways, when you started, when you went to Australia to go to university, did you already have the mindset like, I want to pursue stand-up? Or is that something you stumbled on? Or is this something you always passionately loved when you were living in Singapore and Malaysia?
I didn't have any idea I'd do stand-up comedy. I went to Australia for law school. Like, I graduated from law school in Australia. And law school here is undergraduate. So I was like an undergrad lawyer. And then I couldn't I couldn't get a job, and so I just kept doing comedy instead.
I know, but you got to explain why you went to comedy, because can't just say I graduated, became a lawyer, and then I was like, you know what? Let me go over and get some money out that That's comedy fair. Club. Like, what was the passion behind it? Were people telling you you were funny at university?
No. Everyone told me not to do it. Everyone told me don't do it. For real, they were like, don't do it. You're gonna suck. And
no shit.
Yeah. They all said you're gonna eat a lot of shit. Don't do it. And I don't
know. But
you
were never the funny guy. You were never the funny guy in the crowd, or the funny guy in the group.
Everyone's the funny guy, right? It's like what Seinfeld.
No.
Yeah, it's like what Seinfeld said. Seinfeld was like, yeah, everyone was funny when growing up. Wasn't everybody funny? Like, you know, like everyone's funny. So
I don't know. A lot of people are annoying. They're annoyingly funny. And then there's people that have the gift. There's the people that have the gift.
Okay. And now they're annoying because we're professionals now, right? So as professionals, we're like, these guys are annoying. But when you're not a professional, you're like, everyone's funny. Like, you know. Like, but anyway, so I would see stand-up comedy. And specifically, I mean, when I was a kid, I grew up in New Hampshire as well. Manchester,
Jesus
New Hampshire.
Christ.
Yeah. So I was in Manchester, New Hampshire.
James Bond?
Yeah. What the fuck are you, man?
My parents
went
to.
Are you a secret agent? What are you, man?
My parents went to New Hampshire for college. They went really late. They had two kids, and then they went to college in America. So they brought us along. So we were like in this, you know, my parents were going to college when we were in America. And I was like 3 years old. And then I stayed there till I was 7 years old. And then I went back to Singapore. Like, my parents were really good immigrants. They didn't take jobs. They got educated and they left.
They went back to Singapore.
They went back to Singapore. Yeah. They're like, we don't want to take any jobs. We're just going to get education. And they did very well for themselves. You know, the education actually got them, you know, corporate executive jobs in Singapore. So,
That's awesome.
I remember watching Seinfeld in Manchester, New Hampshire, and going like, you know, the bits you would do at the end of the episode, and going like, man, that's really cool. Mom, I think I want to do that. Like, I want to do that, you know, telling jokes to people in a room.
Okay.
And my mom,
so then that inspired you. Yeah. How old were you when you said that to your mom?
I was like four, but
no shit.
Yeah, but I didn't do anything about it for literally 20 years. I didn't think about it. I didn't work on it. Yeah. And so,
but that was your inspiration. That's dope.
Yeah. Yeah, just seeing Seinfeld do the bits at the end. I was like, man, that looks really cool. And then when I was 25, it was my final year of university. And I remember going like, there was this campus comedy competition at my university. And if I didn't sign up now, I would never get a chance to do it because I'm graduating. So I there was something in my head where I was like, I think I can do this, but I just want to confirm it. So that's really what the bug was. Like, I think I can do
it.
People in a room laugh with jokes, but I just really want to make sure. So I went to do it. And then you guys know the drug. Once you do it once, it's like, then
once
you get hooked.
It's over.
And then it becomes, how do I get this again? How do I get this again? I need to get the next joke. I need to get the next joke, you know? And then it became like, very quickly for me, it became like, I want to do it to strangers. I don't want any of my friends to ever come and see this because I don't want to become the guy who's only selling to people who know me. I need to do it to people who have no emotional investment in anything I'm doing, and just to really confirm. So even till now, for me, it's just a confirming, like, hey, is this funny? Like, my whole the whole comedy for me is just continuously just trying to confirm whether this thing I just thought, is it actually funny? And I'm trying to get people to come. Yeah.
That's sick,
what it is,
man.
Until now. Yeah.
So it's then just, it's
crazy.
And what year was that when you graduated? When you graduated university and started 2009. So you started stand up in 2009?
Yeah.
Holy shit, bro. What a rise.
Bro. No, I'm still learning how to do it, you know, still very much a baby in it. So
But god damn it, you made a decision in 2009 and then you became part of the biggest fucking Asian movie of all time. one of the biggest movies of all time.
I got really lucky.
Wow, 11. How many years ago is that? 3 years ago now? Crazy rich Asians?
2018, I guess 2018.
So from 2009 to 2018, right?
Yeah, that's pretty cool.
Yeah.
That's pretty amazing, bro. Pretty fucking cool. I just want you to know my Netflix special, which wasn't given to me, I had to pay for that motherfucker. Took me 27 years. Just want you to know that.
Yeah, but also, I mean, look, I got really lucky with people giving me giving me chances, and I feel like every time someone gave me a chance, I feel like I always delivered, you know? Yeah. So, I mean, but that's the thing, right? Like, none of us can make anything without someone believing in us or helping us at some point. Someone had to believe in you.
Oh, 100%.
Even in something like stand-up comedy, which is one of the most solo sports in the world, right? Alan Havey, the great Alan Havey, always says, like, with stand-up comedy, we're in it for ourselves, but we're in it together. And, like, there's no one got a gig. Even that open mic room, someone had to believe in you and be like, yeah, okay, you can come on. You know, you're not a complete 100%. Psycho. So, I got really lucky with people, you know, really giving me chances. And I tried to always pay it back by making sure I did a good job and not screwing it up, you know.
Yeah. Preparation is key. My stepdad always said that, man. People that aren't prepared are failures. and you were prepared, bro. So, you know what I mean? Much respect to that. Because once you left Australia, you went where? Did you stay in Australia and continue stand-up? Or how did you land The Daily Show? How did you get all that stuff? Where did that come in?
I was in Australia doing comedy 2009, and I was doing okay here. You know, Australian audiences, for the most part, I think, kind of got behind me and what I was saying and what I was doing. And so I was doing like 1,000 seat theaters here. Maybe 3 or 4 years in, I was able to kind of tour around the country, make a decent living. You know, and it's also a different market here. Like, you honestly, to make it financially viable here, you have to go to theaters. Like, that's just how it's not even it's not even a luxury thing. It's more like this is the business model. Obviously it's hard to get to the point where you can actually sell, but that's the goal, you know? So we were always kind of trending towards that. That's why in America, I always tried to think like you know, trying to think in terms of going to theaters and having people come who want to be there. Is a big part of comedy. And so I was doing that, and then I was also doing the international circuit. You know, I was doing Edinburgh Fringe. I did Edinburgh Fringe like 3 times. And I did Montreal. You know, I was going around the world kind of doing this, doing stand up. And in Montreal, I got to meet, I got to do a show with Trevor Noah. And Trevor was someone who I knew from the circuit because he's the guy who would come to Australia and be the talk of the town, you know, and we would all these Australian comics would be there trying to peddle our hour, and then Trevor would come and just blow the place up, you know. And he's actually legendary in Edinburgh because he started, Edinburgh is a crazy festival. If you don't know, Edinburgh is the largest live performing festival in the world.
It's incredible.
Is one small part of it. And it's already huge. Comedy is huge at the Edinburgh Fringe, and it's just a fraction because they've got music, they've got musicals, they got plays, they got ballet, dancing, magicians, juggling. They got, you know, comedy.
Everything.
It's bananas. It's one of the reasons. It's really interesting for the listeners who might not know anything about the Fringe. It's really interesting because it's the only one that it's basically the Wild West. So there's not really a gatekeeper so much at the Fringe. Like, there's a few different houses that'll do the best at promoting you, but if you can get a venue and a microphone in Edinburgh in the month of August, you're part of the Fringe. Like, nobody can really stop you.
So there's like 5,000 shows, I think, going on.
Yeah, it's crazy. It's
literally 5,000 shows.
And mind you, remind everybody that it's not just a show. It's usually a residency that goes for about 3 weeks.
Every day of August at a certain time. I'm going to be at 6 p.m. every day at this one venue, basically.
Yes.
So it's a real marathon. It's really, it's this mental and physical, and if you gotta love performing to be there, and like you said, you're doing an hour every day of your show, which maybe you spend most of the afternoon flyering, essentially begging people to come. Sometimes you might get one or two people in your show, you know, like some days there's just two audience members, some days there's 10, some days there's 20, whatever it is, you know, wherever your profile is. So it's tough, it's a grind. And Trevor, in that environment, he went from the start of the festival, he went from like a 30-seat, 50-seater. By the end of the festival, he was in the biggest venue in Edinburgh, 1,500.
Wow.
And that's unheard of in that you know, so he was doing really well in terms of you, like, you can't fake the funk, you know, it's not, you can't, that's not just hype. That's people are really picking up what you're putting down. And Eddie Izzard was promoting him, which was huge, but you know, that's not the reason why people came. People came because he was good, you know, and Eddie Izzard promoted him because he was good. And so he was just kind of like fresh face, but really kind of blowing up in the circuit. And so I was in Montreal, and I knew of him peripherally, but you know, we weren't hanging out or anything. And I did a show with him, actually the Eddie Izzard gala. So again, shout out to Eddie Izzard for letting me go on the gala. Again, another instance of someone giving people a shot, you know. And I guess I did pretty well at the gala there. And Trevor and I talked, and he wanted me to come to South Africa and do a gig. And then we didn't talk for 2 years. Like, we didn't even exchange numbers. And then 2 years later, I get this email asking me to audition for a Daily Show. And I suspected it was him, but I couldn't be sure, you know. It's not like he gave me a heads up. And, you know, I auditioned for it and from Australia. And then I did a chemistry test with Trevor in the studio in New York. And yeah, I got hired on a show. And then I find out later that, yeah, he was promoting me. And he didn't need to do that, you know, because one, we weren't like close friends or anything. Yeah. I'm sure he had funnier friends. He had closer friends. He probably owed tons of favors to. But he felt very strongly that the show needed that Asian voice on it. And I'm very lucky that I was the one he chose to do that. But my point to all this is that he didn't have to do that. He wanted to do that because he wanted to give underrepresented people a voice on the show, you know. Yeah. And like, he didn't need to do that. It's totally, in some ways, against his interest. But anyway,
I want to interrupt you real quick, because you always say the word lucky, and you're not. Like, you are very talented. You're talented, bro. Lucky is a description you use when a motherfucker is like, I was juggling and now I'm in a circus. It's like, lucky. Like, no, you're not lucky, bro. Like, you're fucking talented. When I give you your compliments, that's a real thing, man. Like, acting is beautiful. But your fucking comedic timing is, your hustle, your grind, and you're talented. And your talent, like, you said, you weren't friends with Trevor, but whatever you did on stage, that buried inside his brain. And when he had that opportunity, he's like, I got the guy. And
but we all know guys who are good. Super funny guys, 100%. You know, and a lot of it is
Ronnie,
luck,
you're unique. You work really hard. You've got a unique voice, and you're really, really, really good. And you also are just a decent person. And so you fucking deserve it. And Joe's right.
Well, thanks. I'll take the compliment. So anyway, 100%. I did get a lot of people believing me. So thanks a lot.
Yeah, man. Like, you are. You just are, man. I've always been a fan. I love your shit, man. I love watching you. It's a style that I've always enjoyed. You know what I mean? Like, it's just sick, bro. Oh, and thanks, and people need to watch it. Where can they go right now to see your stand-up?
Well,
where can they go? I'm talking in their homes. Where can they go see Ronnie?
Oh, okay.
Chan?
Please go to Netflix and click on Ronnie Chang, Asian Comedian Destroys America. And watch it to the end. There's a lot of thoughts in the...
Yeah. I love it.
Thanks so much.
I love the theme. I love the theme that you had with the whole 50s style. Like, I love that, bro. Like,
thanks. Yeah, no, I was trying to do...
Hey, Ronnie, I know you laugh a lot when I say these compliments, but I want you to know these are genuine compliments.
You almost have to say that because I'm on your podcast. But
I don't have to say that. If I didn't like you, bro, this shit would have ended 30 minutes ago. Like,
yeah, no, I really appreciate it. Thanks for promoting it, man. You're always promoting my stuff a lot. Yeah, my visual...
Yeah, do I not promote your shit without you even asking? I do that shit. And I don't do that for a lot of people, man. I only do it for the ones that make me fucking laugh.
Thanks a lot. Yeah. Thanks a lot. No, Joe's always been promoting my stuff. I really appreciate it. I wish I could, you know, I feel like when I promote your stuff is like completely useless. Like, what am I doing promoting to
I'm already selling out arenas. Don't worry about that.
I know. So it's like, what am I doing here? I'm just like, you know, it's just a show to like be like, oh yeah, Joe, I'm also promoting your 24 sold out run at the Hawaii Arena.
All right, whatever. Let's not forget the forum. Okay, anyways, that's enough. No, in no way does, you know, anyone that does something out of the goodness of the heart because they're expecting it to come back, then they're not doing it for real. You know what I mean? I don't like those kind of people, and I don't expect you to give me anything back like that. But it is dope that Trevor Noah saw that beautiful talent that you possessed, and he always kept that to his heart. And when he had the opportunity, he made that happen. And you do the same thing, Ronnie. The next cat that inspires you, and you got that opportunity to give it to him, man, give it to him, bro.
Oh, absolutely.
You know what I mean? And that's what this, especially like you said earlier, it is a very lonely and solo world that we live in, man. I've been on the road for I can't even tell you how long. And there's a lot of times where I didn't get to go to my son's birthdays. I sacrificed a lot, man. And it is very lonely, and it is a solo thing. So that old mentality that was in the past where cats didn't really help each other, man, that's whack, man. Like Trevor Noah and I like to say myself likes to pay it forward. And it's cool that you're that dude, man. Like, yo, I love your shit, man. Congrats.
Yeah, thanks so much, man.
Yeah, man. Yeah. I can't wait to see what else you got for the big screen. I think you directing something would be really dope, man. I can already see it.
Yeah, thanks a lot. Yeah, I'm just trying to get to the next joke right now. So forget directing. I'm just trying to write this next bit for the stage. Yeah.
Oh, dude. You know what's crazy is, the Bruce Lee documentary came out, right?
Yeah.
And one thing that a lot of people didn't know is that the guy was a performer since he was a kid.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? The guy was, you know what I mean? He knew, like, you know, one thing that I always knew, you know what I mean? But you know, his inspirations was Muhammad Ali and jiu-jitsu. And he was ahead of his time. Like, you know, there was a lot of people that were hating on him because he was like, hey, let's throw all the martial arts in and every technique, because when the fight happens, you have to do everything. So anyways, long story short, what I'm trying to say is a lot of people don't know that entertainment is in our blood. You know what I mean? And is that something that was in your blood? Like Bruce Lee was, you know, we all know him as this kung fu expert, but we didn't know that he was an entertainer as well.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Yeah. And same thing with me. Like I knew I wanted to be a comic, but I didn't know, like, in my family, we had singers and all this stuff that was in our blood. And it just, like, indirectly, it kind of motivated. How about you? Was that in your blood?
I mean, I don't think it was. I don't think it was, because even up till the Daily Show, when I got the Daily Show job, I always felt like one foot was out the door. You know, I always was like, I'm supposed to stop this now, right? Like, I can't keep doing this. There's no way this can keep going. So in my head, I was always like, oh yeah, this is, you know, this is going to stop soon. It was until I got the Daily Show and I was in New York and I was regularly getting gigs in New York, which is kind of living the dream. It's like you work in a Daily Show in the day, and then at night you run around Manhattan trying to do 5-6 shows. That's like living the dream. And it's only during that time was when I was like, oh damn, yeah, I could actually do this. That was,
wow, really? Yeah.
Before that, it was always one foot out the door. And
how did your family accept it? Did they love the fact that you became an entertainer?
Not really. I kind of didn't tell them I was doing it. I just went to go do it.
Crazy.
Because they lived in a different country. Yeah. They didn't even. Yeah. So it was easy to hide it. And I'm not one to, like, you know, my dad was always like a guy who, like, you want to show results. You don't want to be talking about stuff, you know. So my thing was like, I don't want to talk about what I'm doing. I just want to let it speak for itself and maybe hopefully show some results. And I think that tactic paid off, because I never told them I was doing it in their heads. And what I was actually, the truth was, I was also getting my legal qualifications. Yeah. So I had that excuse of, like, when they asked me what I was doing, I was like, oh, I'm still trying to pass the bar, you know. Yeah. Which was actually true. And then I ended up passing the bar in Victoria in Australia, but I just took way longer than you needed to, you know, as an excuse.
I'm trying to pass this bar while doing stage time, Dad.
Yeah. And then what happened was that, eventually I was doing it well enough that Singapore press started reporting on it. And that's how they found out, because they read the newspaper in Singapore. And then when the Singapore press, you know, like, Asian parents are like, it doesn't matter what you tell them. It nothing. They're like, you, everything you say is you're either exaggerating it or you're lying.
Yeah.
It's only if a third person says it, then they're like, oh shit.
Oh shit. Yeah.
Oh shit.
Yeah.
Yo, this guy says that you're doing comedy and you're good, man.
That's
this
so
guy,
true.
You know what I mean? Like if you tell them, like, hey, I'm doing comedy, I think I'm going okay. They'd be like, that is, you're probably doing awful. You're probably bad at it. And you should stop. And you're probably losing money.
You must be homeless.
Yeah. People probably hate it. Yep. Right. You're probably being attacked every time you go on stage at how bad you. So it's until like a third person is like, hey, I saw Ronnie. He's actually really good. Then they're like, oh my God, this person, you know, so.
I'm with you on that one. When I told my mom I had the Tonight Show, she's like, oh, okay. Well, we'll see how that goes. And then when it came on, my mom was like, oh my God, everyone's talking about the Tonight Show. I was like, oh shit, man.
Yeah. Even when I told my dad, eventually I had to tell him I got, so this was early on, right? Then eventually I got the Daily Show.
Yeah.
And then I didn't even tell my dad I got the Daily Show. I just like, you know, for me, it was like, it doesn't matter what you get, it's what you're doing. And so he read it in the news and then he was like, hey, so what's this I hear about you getting the Everyday Show? And I'm like, Oh, yeah. It's the Daily Show. It's this political satire show in America. It's pretty popular. And he's like, oh, okay. So are you the host? And I'm like, no, I'm the correspondent. I'm a correspondent on the show. And he's like, oh, what's a correspondent? It's like, oh, I help the host with like comedy segments in studio and outside of studio. And then he's like, oh, okay. Hey, May, he's just a sidekick. And then I was like,
oh, shit.
Yeah. So I was like, that's pretty normal. And then within a week of me getting it, my dad like Googled like everything about it. He was telling me Jon Stewart's salary, you know, and I was like,
oh, yeah, that's so funny.
Yeah. So he got into it eventually, but that's
funny. You know, I was talking to Jimmy O Yang. And
Jimmy's the best.
I love Jimmy, man. That's my dude. And we're just talking about how his comedy career took off. And then next thing you know, he's got Silicon Valley. And then, you know, then he got Crazy Rich Asians. And then, you know, his dad used to be like this stern dad. And now all of a sudden, his dad's an actor.
Jimmy's book is super funny. And he talks about this. He goes like, Jimmy was becoming like a legit actor, you know, with regular work on Silicon Valley, and his dad, Jimmy's dad, went, oh, that looks easy. I can do it. And he did.
And then he's like a legit actor right now.
Yeah. His dad's on Space Force with him.
Oh,
on Netflix.
That's so funny, dude.
His dad is killer. I know his dad as well. He's a great guy. Yeah. It's so funny.
Oh, it's so funny, man. It's cool to see that, man. My mom gets flown out for for her to do speeches. It's like, because it's Joko's mother. It's like, tune in tonight. We're interviewing Joko's mother. It's like, Jesus Christ.
In Philippines.
In America. They fly her out everywhere. Oh, they fly her to DC. They fly her to New York. Like,
right.
She's accepting awards. I like to accept this award. Or my son, loves you.
What's interesting to me about you, not just how, you know, how legendary your comedy career is and how well you're blowing up, is also how much like we have that Southeast Asian connection.
Yeah.
You know, because there's not a lot of Southeast Asian, like people don't even, Southeast Asia to Americans is a real like black hole. You know, people don't really know what's going on there. Like if you say Southeast Asia, they might go Vietnam. Yep. You know, but even then Vietnam will be of the war, like people getting blown up.
Yeah, that's
like,
true. Yeah.
If we, you know, if I say to me, Southeast Asia is like Malaysia, Singapore, Thailand, Indonesia, Philippines, Laos, Burma, Myanmar, you know, so like there's this whole place in the world that I think most Americans don't know about, which is why I think your special, your comedy is really cool because you bring attention to it. But what was really cool about your special as well is that you brought people back to the Philippines, which I thought was really cool. You know,
Thank you, man.
Show people around and you got the comics on, you know,
it was just that moment, man. It was that moment where I had
really cool.
to get back, man. I opened that door and I'm like, yo, I'm gonna let all these Filipinos in. Let's go. That's what that was about, man.
Yeah. Dude, it was great. Ronnie, and I think,
Well, go ahead. Finish.
No, it was great. And I'm glad people got to see, because I think oftentimes when we show Southeast Asia in America, it's fucking just, It's like refugees or someone like orphans who got, it's just like this, all this misery. And it was, my whole thing is like, you got to show the other side. And so that's what I really love about your special is that you went there and it's, you show people like the dignity and the cool culture that's there. And you know, it was fun. It's fun to see. Yeah, it was great.
I hope that's a blueprint too. I said that in Netflix when I shot it. I go, I hope this is a blueprint that other comics can do. You know what I mean? Like just go and show where you're from and showcase other talents and let the world embrace your culture. That's what that was all about, man. So, hey, I love you for saying that. Thank you.
Yeah, yeah. And that agenda really came through. That authenticity. Like it was clear that you didn't need to do that. You could freaking, you know what I mean? You could just film the special.
I know.
Hawaii, you could have done it in, you didn't need to do that.
Stop saying Hawaii. I go everywhere.
No, I just, the forum.
Son of a bitch.
You could have done, you could have done anywhere. You literally could have done anywhere in the world. And then to go into Philippines and bring other people along and show them, it's a big production, man. Like, I'm watching, just before your special came, I was watching, because I watch your social media all the time. Yeah. And I just put my producer's hat on watching some of this. And I'm like, how the hell is this being filmed? There's like at least two cameras with guys walking around with that, and then you're getting your, you know, the when you're walking down the street. Anyway, the production value. I'm like, man.
And we did that in 4 days, Ronnie.
I know. I can't.
And I was on a world tour. I was on a world tour, and I flew there, and I shot that in 4 days, and we wrote it there. So it was crazy, man. Thank you. I love you for that, man. Yeah. That was a passion project, and it took a lot of me.
Yeah.
It took a lot of my soul to do that.
And also, good job, Brian.
Yeah.
Thanks, buddy.
Brian had nothing to do with it, goddammit. Ronnie, congratulations to all your success, bro.
Thanks so much. Thanks for having me on. Good to see. I didn't expect to see Brian on this. No one briefed me on, but good to see you.
I always just sneak up on people.
Yeah, man. I love the fact that you have six hats on a hat rack over there. That's a beautiful thing. I hope you get to some of those post-its on your bulletin board.
This is.
But God bless you through this pandemic, man. And when this is all said and done, bro, I can't wait to see you in person. And like I said, if you're in New York, I'm playing Radio City Music Hall, bro, and I want you. I told you this before. I want you on it, bro.
Shit, that would be crazy. I'd love to do that. Yeah.
I would love you to walk out.
Yeah, no, don't call it now. If you have a bigger favor, if you owe someone a favor.
I don't do favors, bro. I only put
yo. If we're still alive, if the Radio City isn't occupied by like squatters who have abandoned their bombs. Yeah. Well, you know, for sure. Yeah. Even if it is occupied.
We're coming back from this. Everything's coming back. The Daily Show's coming back. Ronnie Chang's coming back. I'm going to be at Radio City Music Hall. It's already sold out, by the way.
Yeah, I know.
And I want my boy Ronnie Chang to just share the stage, bro. That'd be dope, man.
Thanks, man. That'll be killer. Thanks a lot.
I love you for your kind words, and thank you for what you do for the culture, my guy. You're the shit. You're a real one. So thank you for being on this one.
Thanks for paving the way, man. Thanks
for being on.
Brian, love you, bro.